WF House presents an unabridged recording of After Paris by Nicole Kennedy, narrated by Charlie Sanderson. Chapter 1. Hôtel des Clients, Paris, 1999.
She's disappeared,
Teddy huffed, and Alice arranged her mouth into a smirk. Unease had restructured his already exquisite features, rendering his face pensive and brooding, his cerulean eyes glazed sulkily, his fulberry lips pouting. It was so unfair that he looked so good all the time, even now as his distress escalated. She didn't fancy Teddy. Lordy, he was practically her brother. But she could appreciate fine art when she saw it, and Teddy Astor, with his fine bone nose and sharp lined cheekbones, was a subject worthy of the old masters. Pity he was such a pain.
I'm sure she'll turn up. She's hardly going to miss Labelle,
Alice replied, a yawn in her voice, as though Teddy's problems were just so tedious to her, and there wasn't a delicious justice in him being stood up at the society function of the year.
Chunky, he'd called her. Chunky.
And she hadn't forgotten it.
She might. She's French, he said, as if that explained everything.
Around them, the lobby bustled with activity. Women dripping with pearls. The press dripping with long-lens cameras.
There must be someone high-profile here, Alice observed.
The list of debutantes was always a closely guarded secret, adding to the mystery and glamour of the event. Teddy ran a hand through his hair nervously, and the effect was so enthralling Alice had to look away. She was fortunate she was impervious to his charms.
What are you doing out here anyway?
Avoiding your mother, he answered, somber.
He signalled to the barman for a drink, a gesture that seemed to transform him from a boy to a man.
When did he start doing that?
Alice put a hand on his arm.
Well, I can't argue with that, but there's no time for a drink. Come on, let's get this over with.
This is all your fault, you know. Why couldn't you have debuted in London like everyone else? Always got to be different, haven't you?
He looked skyward, as if praying for something. Divine intervention from tonight, perhaps. Alice had been asking herself the same thing. She'd liked the idea of being more anonymous in Paris, of not feeling like she was being sized up against her contemporaries when she'd spent her whole life doing that herself. And of course, Mummy was thrilled with the suggestion, immediately tapping into her extensive network of influential friends to secure her and Teddy an invitation. But rather than making her feel less visible, as she'd hoped, the new surroundings were having the opposite effect. At least she knew where she was in London. At least she could chatter her way around the room, outrunning her nervousness, and dock off somewhere with Lulu and talk about how unflattering her pale lilac blue lace dress was, and yes, Lulu often made her feel 100 times worse, but at least the whole scene would be familiar. She wouldn't feel the rising sense of being adrift that she was experiencing here.
She's wearing yellow, apparently. The Frenchie, Nina Laurent, so she shouldn't be too hard to spot.
His mouth formed a line of distaste, as though he'd eaten something sour. Alice didn't answer, but obviously she hoped Nina Laurent was a total bitch and ugly to boot. Her mother's wish had been for Teddy to be her cavalier, but Alice had prayed for the formidable Madame Chapelle, Labelle's imperious organiser, to allocate her someone else. And her prayers had been answered, in the form of a tall, fair, serious-looking Swiss count.
Sounds delightful, doesn't she?
Alice shrugged.
I met the count earlier,
he added in a teasing tone, and with a look on his face which said, lucky you. She rolled her eyes. She'd already had her fill of jokes from her father, whose only contribution to this evening, beyond attending as a lord himself, had been a steady stream of puns.
I bet you're counting down the days. You can count on it.
Their attention shifted as another debutante crossed the lobby. Alice looked around furtively, nervous of reproach from Madame Chapelle if they were spotted. The debutantes weren't supposed to be out here. They were meant to be tucked away, hidden like precious jewels about to go up for auction. But every now and then a gem escaped, gliding across the lobby to speak to a parent or whisper something to a sibling. Alice wished she had a sister here to talk to. Not Teddy, whom her mother had taken under her wing when his parents died 10 years earlier. Alice watched Teddy's eyes follow the young woman. She was wearing a long pale pink gown that snagged on her hip bones, a tiara atop her blonde hair which fell in glossy curls around her shoulders. Lordy, how Alice wished something would snag on her hip bones. Most of the debutantes looked like supermodels, and Alice cursed herself again. You can't disappear in a place like this. As Teddy's eyes tracked the girl in pale pink around the room, Alice felt a deep ache tugging in her chest. Would anyone ever look at her that way? She's out of your league, she said, and smirked again. Why did she always smirk so much around Teddy? He cocked his head as though considering this. It had been a while since Alice had last seen him. It was the previous summer at the Hurlingham Club, with the unforgettable chunky incident. She'd beaten him at tennis, and he'd attributed this to her chunky thighs, making her four brothers roar with laughter. He'd spent October term in Hong Kong with a cousin, rather than with them, as sometimes happened. She suspected he was steering clear of her mother, who was keen for them to coordinate their gap year plans. But he needn't worry. Alice had no intention of travelling with Teddy Astor. She and Lulu already had a rough itinerary, although the thought of being in a bikini next to Lulu brought her out in hives. I think being at La Belle puts me exactly in her league, he said finally. And as Alice caught his eye, she realised he too understood that his stock had recently gone up. Teddy Astor. Hitherto a gangly, awkward teen, but now on the cusp of being a man. Was gorgeous. It was lucky she despised him, or she'd be in serious trouble. In the lobby of the hotel, perched awkwardly on a circular leather banquette, a copy of The Economist pressed against her lap, Julia Frey was doing that thing she always did after talking to a boy. Running and rerunning their exchange in her head, cringing at the things she'd said, admonishing herself for the witty, interesting things she could have said. Why was speaking such a basic, perfunctory thing so difficult sometimes? Julia rarely said much, even though at any given time thousands of words galloped through her mind, a fizzing backdrop of linguistic opportunity and regret. Valentin. Even his name was French and sexy. The thing she wished she could say to him. She couldn't even blame the language barrier, since his English was excellent, and that was how they mostly conversed, to her annoyance and relief. Julia was an almost straight-A student. The only subject she struggled with, the only subject that might lower her international baccalaureate points and scupper her chance of studying maths at Cambridge, was French. So, when she had to make plans for a work experience placement, she'd convinced her parents to allow her to do hers in Paris. She requested a business opportunity, but had wound up in a pharmacy, which seemed not so bad when she met Valentin on her first day. But that was a whole 2 weeks ago, and today had been her last day. There'd been no signs he had even noticed her until this afternoon, and then, of course, she'd blown it. Now he thought she was some uber-posh rich kid, which she wasn't. Middle class, but not posh. Comfortable, not rich. The only reason she could attend her school was thanks to her academic scholarship and a reduction in fees because her mother taught English there. That's how she'd wound up doing the IB, and not A-levels, as she'd have preferred. Why did she tell Valentin she was coming here, to Le Bal? Okay, he'd said with an awkward grimace. She hadn't realised he was about to invite her to the bar he was heading to with the others. You have friends there. he asked, surprise and disdain in his voice as he appraised her again, making a fresh assessment of her family and economic circumstances. Her smart black suit trousers, her pinstriped shirt, the delicate pearl earrings gifted from her grandmother, which she now regretted wearing. Sort of. She shrugged, not wanting to lie, nor tell the truth. She cursed herself again as she scanned the lobby, her fingers tightening around the economist. The truth was, people watching was a hobby of hers. She loved to observe people when they thought no one else was watching. Enjoyed overhearing conversations and imagining the context, the stories they divulged. And nowhere was better to people watch than the annual Le Bal at the Hôtel de Crillon. When Julia had realised she'd be in Paris for it, she'd marked it in her diary in capitals and underlined it. The people she could watch. Like the couple over there. A tall, handsome boy in white tie, with a pretty, slightly chubby girl in a blue lace dress with capped sleeves and a full-tiered skirt cinched round her waist with a wide satin sash. She was trying her best to tease him about something, but the flush on her cheeks and the way she kept angling her body towards his was giving her away. They were looking around them, for a parent, perhaps, or a friend. What were their worries right now, she wondered. Was he bored? Roped into this by a relative? Perhaps she had a boyfriend, because it seemed to Julia as if everyone else in the world had a boyfriend except for her. But she liked this boy better. Across the lobby, she noticed a hotel manager watching her closely. She'd arrived after work, and in her smart attire had walked straight inside, but that was a couple of hours ago, and the lobby was beginning to fill with photographers and guests. She sensed it was time to leave. She wasn't sure how much more she'd be able to see anyway. She could hardly sneak into the ballroom where La Belle was held. Would it be weird if she joined Valentin at the bar in Le Marais now, turning up late when she'd told him she had other plans? She stood quickly and made her way to the restrooms, but a queue had formed. She continued walking, in no rush, and enjoying the buzz around these people who were, in theory, quite close to her world. She was at one of the best independent schools in the country, after all. But in practice, were eons away. Someone like Julia would never be able to gain entry to an event like this. If only Jennifer, her best friend, and the other scholarship pupil in her year could see her now. Jennifer was obsessed with the London socialites, poring over Tatler the same way Julia did the Financial Times in preparation for her future secondment interviews. She had a clear career trajectory mapped out. Cambridge, and then financial analyst at one of the large investment banks in the city. She found a restroom away from the main lobby, tucked down a small corridor. It was quiet, an oasis of calm compared to the melee in the central atrium. She peered at herself in the mirror, evaluating her face from different angles and frowning. It had been 2 hours since she'd left the pharmacy and last applied makeup in the cramped cupboard toilet at the back, and some shine was creeping in. Sometimes she feared she was destined to spend the rest of her life at her dressing table, staring into her vanity mirror, charting the rise and fall of empires on her face. The blackheads on her forehead, the whiteheads around her nose, the lurkers, small angry lumps beneath her skin that lay like dormant volcanoes, hot to the touch, but offering no sign of release. She wrote everything down in her diary, hoping that this scientific approach might someday provide an explanation for what she referred to internally as the state of her face. She could have been beautiful. That was the huge injustice of it. Her hair was long and blonde, her body toned and taut from hockey and barely eating. A body like Baywatch, a face like Crime Watch. That's what she'd heard a boy in her Duke of Edinburgh's award group say as the others laughed. Fuck you, she would frequently think. Fuck all of you. When I'm earning enough to have my skin lasered, or whatever advancements lay ahead. Until then, she applied makeup. Lots and lots of makeup. She needed her toolbox, she thought, reaching for her hefty bag, glad to have this bathroom to herself. Oh. She started at the unmistakable sound of crying. She considered leaving. Tearful situations were not her speciality. She was practical, concise. She could explain the law of indices or accurately predict a chemical equation. She could not dissect a text from a boy or console a friend while they tearfully complained about their mother. It was for this reason some of the girls at school branded her cold or sometimes frigid. She hated that word, with its Miss Havisham undertone. As if all the other girls were gamely shagging or dishing out blowjobs every night after school. She wasn't more frigid than anyone else, surely. They were 17 and at an all-girls school. And then there were her clothes. Whatever she tried, she always seemed to get it wrong. The other girls laughing that her outfits were too loud or too clashy. It was why she was wearing practically a uniform today, so she couldn't get it wrong. She did as she always did. Told herself it didn't matter. Because it didn't. She was bright and she was focused. And she'd get out of that school and she'd get a good job. And she'd make enough money to fix her skin properly and she'd be a success. She felt certain that of all the things she couldn't control, her success was a surety. But she was feeling a little different tonight. There was something about being here for Le Bal, in this beautiful hotel. Something about knowing Valentin had invited her to join him and the others. She felt emboldened. She felt like maybe she could have something to add sooner than she thought. She approached the closed door, her heart tap dancing in her chest, and rapped her knuckles against the wood. "Est-ce que vous ça va?" she asked. "Are you okay?" Not knowing what she would do if the occupant replied in rapid-fire French. She stood there for a moment, excited to have stepped out of her comfort zone, but apprehensive, silence permeating the space. She tapped over her forehead gently, moved her fingertips in small circular motions over the hot lumps, before realising she'd need to press powder onto them again. She couldn't have known this moment would change her life, and yet she was holding her breath.
"J'ai besoin d'aller dans ma chambre," the voice replied tearfully, in staccato, faltering French.
The voice belonged to someone young, perhaps a similar age to Jules. As she translated in her head, "She needs to go to her room," her sense of intention dissipated. "Why am I getting myself involved in this?"
"Okay," she said aloud, thinking through her response.
Behind her, she heard someone else enter the restroom. She glanced over her shoulder, distracted, and saw the girl in the ruffled blue dress. The Deb. Oh, God. She hated speaking French in front of other people. Mortifying.
Avez-vous...
She closed her eyes, heat flushing her entire face. She'd really have to go to town with the powder after this.
"No, désolé, can I help?"
the Deb asked, appearing beside her, a keen, interested look on her face. She was beautiful up close, with soft, creamy skin and arresting sapphire eyes. She smelled of roses and hairspray. Her chestnut brown hair swirled and secured around the nape of her neck, a thick wave of fringe curving over one side of her perfectly clear forehead.
"I speak French."
"Of course you do," thought Julia, picturing chateaus in France and alfresco dinners at long tables laden with fresh flowers and red wine. At their interaction, a gasp erupted from behind the door.
"You're English?"
"Yes," Julia said, turning back and placing her hands on the closed door.
"You too? Are you okay?"
she called into the wood. She heard a loud sniff and nose blowing from inside the cubicle.
"Can you help me? I need to get up to my room without anyone seeing me, and I don't have my room key. I've made a mistake. A gross mistake. Oh, damn it," she muttered. "Why am I slipping into French? I've been trying to speak French all week and I can't."
Alice was trying not to look too excited by this exchange.
She'd only popped into the loo because she needed some air before the ceremony. But now there was this poor girl crying, and this other girl, who was dressed like a middle-aged accountant, but appeared to be around her age, seemed out of her depth. She was tall, her face blotchy, red heat battling with a thick layer of makeup, and winning. She had oval eyes that glowed a pale green. Their rapid movement reminded Alice of dragonflies darting over the lake at her family's estate in the summer. Her anxiety was palpable.
"What shall we do?" Alice whispered. "I'm Alice, by the way."
"Julia," the girl replied, and she stuck out her hand as though they were concluding a game of lacrosse. Alice didn't know why, but she suspected Julia would be very good at lacrosse. As well as her height, she was lean and had an officious, confident air.
"I don't know," she said, looking around quickly, as though the baroque bathroom might provide an answer.
Behind the door, the sobbing had resumed.
"A big, big mistake," the girl repeated.
"Who are you here with?" Julia asked in a clipped, demanding tone.
"My dad,"
said the voice uncertainly. A soft London accent that Alice was unable to place.
"You're going to have to find him and get a key," Julia said, forthright, as though it was simple.
But Alice was conscious that if it were, this girl wouldn't be hiding in the restrooms of Le Crayon.
"Unless it's him she's trying to avoid," Alice mouthed.
"I can't," the voice sobbed.
"I don't know where he is. It's been like this all week. He dragged me to Paris and then..."
Julia gasped.
"He dragged you?"
Alice exclaimed.
"No, not literally. But he made it sound like it would be fun. And it's not. It's not fun at all."
Julia exhaled quickly, and Alice was torn between being secretly pleased she had a genuine reason to leave and disappointed she couldn't stay.
"I've got to go," she said quietly, peering at Julia's watch and frowning.
For the first time, she noticed Julia's shoes, electric blue with a large satin bow, entirely at odds with the rest of her conservative look.
"Don't go,"
Julia whispered, her tone almost aggressive.
"I have to,"
Alice said, gesturing at her dress, and Julia gave a reluctant nod of understanding.
"Won't they recognise you at the front desk?"
Julia asked, turning back to the door and wishing she'd never intervened. The scene was too highly charged, her ability to be of any use too limited.
"So you can get a key?"
"I guess so, but I can't go out there. I can't leave this room."
"Why ever not?"
asked Alice, astonished. Halfway to the door, but desperate to stay. Inside the toilet stall, Nina pressed more toilet paper beneath her eyes and took three deep, steadying breaths.
"Damn it,"
she muttered, her voice muffled in the confined space. She had her hands on her hips, a small silver purse her grandmother had lent her dangling from her wrist.
"Because I'm dressed like this," she said.
She opened the door, wobbling on her high silver sandals, not the floral Dr. Martens she usually stomped around in, and gestured at her canary yellow dress. With its tight structured bodice, flared feathered skirt, and a fluffy feather trim lining the top of the corset and adorning her wrists, it combined Big Bird with ABBA.
"Wow,"
Alice and Julia said in unison as she stepped out of the cubicle.
"That's quite the look."
Alice felt suddenly grateful for her own dress.
"I saw you earlier in the lobby. You were wearing dungarees. You had a guitar."
She didn't add, "I noticed you because I thought no one should look that good in dungarees. And no one should look that good in that dress."
"You're a Deb."
Her face betrayed what she was thinking.
"Who is she? Why don't I know her?"
It was practically impossible to be a Deb in Paris. That's why Lulu was so annoyed she'd got in. And there were no other British Debs on the list. It was, she suspected, the first time her parents had invoked her title in their supplications, discreet, of course, to Madame Chapelle. And it had given her a weird little jolt to see it on her invitation. Lady Alice Digby.
"Well, yeah, I am and I'm not." Nina scratched her nails through her hair, and Alice realized it wasn't pinned up under her feathered headpiece as she'd first assumed. She had a pixie cut. A pixie cut. A Deb with a pixie cut. And dungarees. She was slim, too, halfway to a Kate Moss waif, with huge hazel eyes and perfectly arched eyebrows. What was she doing here? Crying in the bathroom of Le Crayon at Le Bal. Samir Lawrence, my dad. Nina shrugged to imply nonchalance. But the way she said it was like she had something stuck to her tongue and she was trying to extricate it. Samir Lauren is your father, said the official-looking girl. Did she work at the hotel? Sounding impressed. How old are you? How old is he? 17. I know, right? Fuck. What am I doing here? She removed a cigarette box from under her arm, flicking it open with a thumb and withdrawing a cigarette using her teeth. Alice couldn't help but think it was the coolest thing she'd ever seen. Do you think I can smoke in here? You're a Deb and your father's a film star, Alice shrugged. I think you can do as you please. A cloud passed over Nina's face. She looked as though she might be sick. When in Paris, eh? She said, leaning an elbow against an ornate mirror as she took a drag on her cigarette. She offered Alice and Julia the box. They both shook their heads. Nina shrugged, and the whole exchange seemed so perfectly sophisticated in French that Julia practically swooned. She felt entirely out of place, as she often did, but for the first time, it felt enthralling.
I only just found out. He's my dad, I mean. Well, 6 months ago, when he invited me to this.
She's a Deb with a pixie cut and dungarees and an estranged movie star father. Good grief, thought Alice. This was getting better by the second. But I don't know why he bothered, to be honest. I've hardly seen him. I've mainly had awkward fittings for my dress. Everyone's annoyed at having to leave it so late. And the fuss over these stupid feathers, with my grandmother, who keeps trying to speak to me in French and looking annoyed when I can't reply. I thought this would be exciting, but instead it's... She stubbed out her cigarette against the porcelain sink, her words juddering to a halt as she fought back tears. What's the problem with the feathers? Julia asked, surveying them. She avoided adding, apart from the obvious.
They're jaunty,
Alice supplied, struggling for something positive to say. Last-minute addition, Nina said, after my grandmother spotted my tattoo. She winced and turned her back in their direction. If you looked properly, an aqua-blue shape was just visible above the springy feathers. I am literally half ostrich right now, she said, deadpan, and Alice had to stifle a giggle.
Is that a dolphin? Julia asked.
If anything, so Nina didn't notice Alice, who was fanning her face with a rolled-up hand towel, overcome. She shot her a quizzical look over Nina's shoulder. What? But all Alice could do was shake her head and gulp. She shouldn't be surprised. She'd assumed all debutantes would be affected. Mind you, even Julia could see that Nina didn't appear to be your usual Deb.
Where are you from? She asked. East London. Mile End?
Nina replied, her voice rising at the end as though she wasn't sure it was the right answer.
My mum's Irish, though.
She trailed off, distracted.
I got it first, you know,
she added, an edge of irritation to her voice, as though this was something she'd said many times.
Before Mark Owen,
she added, to Julia's blank look.
The dolphin tattoo.
Julia was totally flummoxed.
I didn't have you down as a take that fan,
Alice said in a small, squeaky voice, as though she was struggling to contain herself. Nina slid onto the floor, tucking her legs beneath her. Julia shot her another look and asked if she was okay. I stopped telling people my dad was a film star when I was 10. Even then I could tell people thought I was mad. I assumed it was a family rumour that had been blown out of proportion, like my dad was really a blue coat at Butlin's or something. but it turns out it's true. Julia fell silent, and Nina couldn't tell if she was sympathizing with her or judging her for not appreciating her luck. She'd called her cousin Erin earlier to tell her how awful everything was, but all Erin could say was, "It sounds so cool." And it wasn't. It really wasn't. For years, she and Erin had speculated on her paternity, gorged on snippets gathered via her Auntie Neve. Could it be real? That Joni had a brief fling with a fledgling movie star? That he scarpered as soon as she told him she was pregnant? But the older Nina grew, the odder it seemed. And it started to make her feel strange when she thought of it, light-headed and unsettled, as though there was a tiny dark spot in her chest, a pinprick widening into a gap. And if she thought about it too much, she had the dizzying sensation that the dark hole might get bigger and bigger until it was all that was left of her. So she stopped talking about it and put it to the back of her mind. She kept busy, baking with Neve, playing her guitar, drinking in the park with Erin. Because as long as the balance was right and the dark hole was satisfied and her brain was left with no time to consider the alternative, things felt good. And then one day, the invitation came. Alice recovered herself as the silence stretched between them, the mood downbeat as Alice and Julia joined Nina on the floor. "So you're Nina Laurent," she said. She shook her head gently. She was beautiful and cool, and her father was Samir Laurent. This was so typical of Teddy. But she couldn't stay cross, because there was such a fragility to Nina. If you had told Alice she was about to meet a movie star's beautiful French debutante daughter, she would never have pictured the girl standing before her. She seemed normal, aside from the haute couture custard dress. If Alice felt out of place here, she could only imagine how Nina was feeling. But Alice could help. They could stick together. Alice instructing her on what was happening and pointing out who to avoid. She did a quick calculation in her head. Yes, if Nina didn't go and Teddy was stood up, it would be gratifying. But perhaps if she and Nina spent the evening together, it could be even better. Maybe they could become friends. "Look, if you're a Deb, we've got to go," she said. "The ceremony starts any minute." "I'm not going," Nina said decisively. "I can't. I can't wear this dress. I can't waltz, especially not with Samir, pretending everything's okay. I don't know what I'm doing here." "But you have to," Julia said. "It's La Belle." Nina blinked rapidly. The eyeshadow the makeup artist had applied heavily on her lids. The metallic shade brought out flecks of amber in her hazel eyes. "She glows," thought Alice. And she guessed Julia thought so too, judging by how often she touched her fingertips to her own face and glanced longingly at the sink, where she'd left a bulging makeup bag. "So?" Nina shrugged. Her face betrayed what she was feeling. She swallowed. "The truth is, I don't think Samir invited me here with the purest of intentions. I thought we'd spend the weekend getting to know each other, ambling around Paris. I didn't know about La Belle, or what it meant. Having an escort, or cavalier, or whatever." Her hands flew around theatrically until she ran out of steam. "I don't know. The whole thing makes me feel grubby, which I don't really understand since I'm in possibly the most beautiful hotel in the most beautiful city in the world. I've always wanted to come to Paris." Nina began to cry again, and Alice slipped her hand into hers. She understood. She hadn't been able to articulate it until now, even to herself. She joked about it with her father, finding a husband at her Deb ball and being married off. The historical backdrop to these events, even though these days they were more about getting dressed up and raising money for charity. But she couldn't shake off the feeling that she was being put on display, and in her case, the exhibit was lacking. That's why she was in Paris. She suspected the sting of rejection, of not being the darling of the ball, would be a little softer here. It mattered less, since she knew no one other than Teddy and now Nina. The count didn't count. She smiled in spite of herself.
I don't want to go either, Alice said softly. Why don't we go together and get it over with?
She squeezed Nina's hand and then stood, shaking out the full skirt of her dress and pulling Nina up too. Beside her, she was aware of Julia, now in front of the mirror, prodding her face.
Where are you going if you don't want to? Nina asked, confused. I don't know, because my parents want me to, I suppose. And it's what everyone does.
Nina looked horrified. Alice cursed herself. She bet Nina Laurent didn't set much store in following society's expectations.
Alice! Teddy hissed suddenly by the door. What are you doing? Everyone's looking for you.
His face wore an angry grimace until Nina stepped out from behind Alice.
Is it possible to hear the sound of a jaw dropping? Alice thought. Hi, Nina said, and she felt the moment. The moment where her world slipped and slid. The moment her eyes locked with Teddy's. This is Nina Laurent, Alice said. And Nina wondered why she said it so emphatically, like Teddy was supposed to know who she was.
This is Teddy Astor, she said, turning to Nina.
Your cavalier.
Nina O'Connell, Nina corrected, frowning. A ruse to mask her embarrassment, because she'd seen the man before her earlier, rushing into a lift, a burst of action, and a musky scent that had left her breathless. She was jacked up on hormones and paternal abandonment, she'd thought, and then scribbled it down in the notebook she always carried with her. Song lyric ideas. She hadn't imagined he might be a cavalier. She'd been picturing someone far less handsome, someone old. Alice looked between the two of them, their attraction unfurling like caramel, and felt instantly panicked.
We're not going,
she announced to Teddy, her arms folded.
What?
Nina exclaimed as Teddy snapped to attention.
What do you mean you're not going?
He asked, working hard to shift his eyes away from Nina.
Alice, it's La Belle. Thousands of girls, hundreds of thousands, would give their right arm to be here right now. You have to go. Imagine if you don't.
Alice did imagine it. She imagined walking out right now, head high, a cool girl, like Nina Laurent or O'Connell, whatever her name was. Not one beset by tradition and expectations and uncomfortably fitting dresses. The whole event was so old-fashioned and showy.
Your whole family will be out, Alice. Your children won't be able to debut.
That's all the more reason not to do it, she cried, feeling revolutionary. Tell my mother.
You are joking. There's no way I'm telling her anything. The Count's already won surplus cavalier, with you not there. If you're both ditching...
His eyes found Nina's again, hesitant but full of expectation.
I'm coming with you.
No,
groaned Alice. But she could see how he was looking at Nina. She could already see how this would play out. The two most beautiful people in a room always find each other, don't they?
Why'd you always have to what?
Nothing,
she tuttered. She knew she was being childish, but all her life it felt like Teddy was always there, commandeering her things. Her brothers, her mother, and now Nina Laurent. She'd met her first, not Teddy.
Oh, God, why did she sound like such a child?
She was 17. Time to grow up, Alice, she seethed to herself silently.
Are you coming?
She asked, meeting Julia's eyes in the mirror. Julia had been watching them as she discreetly reapplied her makeup, using a plethora of tubes and brushes and powders. She felt sorry for Alice, could sense that things were not unfolding in the way that Alice had hoped. Julia had come to La Belle to people watch. To be invited to join some La Belle runaways was beyond her wildest dreams. These were exactly the sort of people who wouldn't give her a second glance at school, who didn't register her with her lowly teacher parent and acneed skin. Imagine when she told Jennifer and word leaked to the cool set. And yet she couldn't. Could she? She was so different to them all.
What did she know about being a debutante or having a movie star father? But she felt connected to them all the same. She didn't believe in fate. She believed in science. And yet even to her it seemed particularly serendipitous that it had been her who had found Nina Laurent. It's not every day you meet a movie star's daughter in the bathroom of Le Crayon, is it? And there was something captivating about Nina Laurent. There was a restlessness to her that Julia recognised. Besides, isn't this partly why she'd come to France? For so long she had felt like she was waiting for her life to start, and now here it was, slowly spinning into action. She was at Laval with two Debs and a Cavalier. Why not? Why not join them? Julia was tired. Tired of always having to weigh things up. Tired of being a bystander and not a participant. She had this growing sense that it was time to live. If not now, then when? I do know a bar we could try, she said. While the others hid from sight, Julia convinced the short man with the reedy voice at the front desk to give her a key to Nina's room. It was her no-nonsense tone and utter unflappability that compelled the concierge to hand it over. I'm Nina Laurent's personal assistant, she repeated imperiously. Economist slapped on the counter. And it's imperative I get that key. A short time later, Alice, Julia and Teddy gazed around Nina's room in amazement. Even by Le Crayon standards, this was really something. In the distance, the Eiffel Tower shone gold against a cobalt blue sky. Nina scrambled around grabbing things and went into the white marbled bathroom to get changed. If we're doing this, Teddy said nervously, we need to do it quickly. Won't your father come to look for you? Your mother definitely will. He shuddered in Alice's direction. Teddy shed his waistcoat, jacket and tie as Alice removed the sash securing her dress so the lace flared loosely. Can I borrow this? She called to Nina, lifting a denim jacket from where Nina had slung it over an armchair earlier. Much better, she thought, holding out the capacious skirt in pinched fingers as she twisted and turned before Nina's full-length mirror. Julia took in the room and her new acquaintance's clothes and once again had a rush of feeling that she was out of her depth. She was dressed for work in a pharmacy, not an exciting night out with three Laval escapees in Paris. As if reading her mind, Alice came over. Look, undo that button. Oh, and that one too, and... To Julia's alarm, Alice lifted her hair up away from her face, pulling it into a high pony as she weighed up her new look. Julia's thick blonde hair was a barrier between her and the rest of the world. She had never worn it up. No, 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 she said quickly, pulling back, her curtain of hair resuming sentry. She noticed Alice's eyes trailing over her skin and offered up a quick, silent plea that she wouldn't comment on it. Sorry, Alice said simply. How about a hat or a scarf? Or I know. Teddy, pass me your waistcoat and bow tie. She helped Julia into the waistcoat, leaving the buttons undone, and draped the bow tie around her shirt collar. Instantly, Julia's smart trousers and pinstriped shirt had added cool, a le smoking effect. Do you have any blue eyeshadow in there? She asked, motioning at Julia's large bag. A few minutes later, she stood back gratifyingly, nodding as she surveyed the effect. Julia's electric blue pumps popping, along with her eyeshadow, now too. When in Paris? Alice grinned. Nina emerged from the bathroom, her dungarees back on with a neon pink crop top underneath. And she'd kept on her yellow headpiece and silver feathered heels. Très chic, non? She laughed nervously, her East London accent just below the surface of her carefully enunciated French. By 9 o'clock, Julia, or Jules, as she was now, had Valentin's arm resting lightly on her shoulders, having recently broken off their kiss to smile at one another nervously. Julia's brain was screeching, Yes, yes, yes!
She had long ago accepted that she would likely start university not only a virgin, but one who had never been kissed. They reached for each other again, delicious kisses growing deeper in the dark, sweaty bar. For the first time in about 5 years, Julia wasn't thinking about her skin. Alice had hooked up with one of Valentin's friends, Jean-Pierre, and had to bite her lip to stop herself giggling. It reminded her so much of her French textbooks from school. Nina was being spun around the dance floor by Teddy, her eyes alive, her headpiece precarious, bits of feather and lace in danger of cascading over her face like flowers trailing down a wedding cake. When Spice Up Your Life came on, Jules and Alice joined them on the dance floor, and they all shook it to the left and slammed it to the right, including Teddy, belly laughing. They swung their arms around each other, singing at the top of their voices, jumping up and down as a new track came on that they all knew. They devised silly dances.
"I call this Le Tour Eiffel,"
Alice shouted, making a triangle shape and then moving her hands around like flashbulbs.
"I do this on the hour," she said.
And each time the clock crawled on to the next hour, one of the others would grab her and shout,
"It's time!"
There was an attempted lift, dirty dancing style, which resulted in Alice and Nina in a heap on the floor, laughing.
"Amateurs," scoffed Julia, because she'd spent hours watching other girls doing this during their gymnastics lessons at school, but had felt too afraid to try herself.
"Come on, Nina, I've got you," she said, grounding herself to the floor and tensing her thighs. Nina stepped back, further back still, at Julia's command. And then she was running and flying and swooping over the dance floor in her dungarees and heels and her stupid yellow headpiece, before she and Julia also ended up on the floor, the three of them crying with laughter.
"You are dazzling," Teddy whispered into Nina's ear a short while later, looping his arms around her and gently spinning her round.
In a shadowy corner of the dance floor, he kissed her, his hand on her neck, eliciting shocks of stardust down her spine, and their bodies pressed together, magnetic. Nina felt suddenly grateful to her movie star father for inviting her to Paris. By 1 a.m, they were all at Valentin's flat in Montmartre. Julia and Valentin were in his bedroom snogging, and Alice, not used to drinking, had fallen asleep in his small sitting room.
"I want to show you my favourite place in Paris," Teddy whispered to Nina.
Since leaving the bar, they had sobered, grown awkward around each other with Julia and Alice close by. It occurred to Nina that the others didn't know they had kissed, even.
"We shouldn't leave Alice."
"We won't be long, and she's sound, though. Jules seems pretty happy in there."
He gestured in the direction of Valentin's bedroom door and grinned. The cold air hit them afresh as they stepped outside, and Teddy raced back up to the apartment, returning with a blanket. He wrapped it over both their shoulders, securing it in place with his left hand and holding Nina's hand with his right. They navigated cobbled streets, laughing when Nina's heels got stuck, pressed side by side for warmth.
"I come here whenever I'm in Paris," Teddy said, pulling Nina up an uneven flight of stairs.
By 3 a.m, Nina was sitting on the top of the steps, outside Le Sacre-Cœur with Teddy. And he had shared with her how both his parents had died when he was young, in a house fire. How they'd managed to bundle him in a blanket and pass him through a small top window to a neighbour. How difficult it had been since. How in every city he visited, he would find a church and light a votive candle for them both. The only way he could think for them to still travel together. At some stage, he'd abruptly changed the subject and made a joke. And they were drunk enough for their conversation to snap like elastic onto lighter matters. Soon they were shooting lines from their favourite films back at each other. She laid her head on his shoulder, and he wrapped his arms and the blanket around her. It was almost freezing, but beer and lust kept them warm. By 5 a.m, they returned to Valentin's flat to retrieve Jules and Alice, and the four of them wandered through the streets of Paris back to Le Crayon, singing Disco 2000, swapping stories and promising each other, swearing on the bow tie of fun, which Julia was swinging around her head, that they would do this every year. They would meet back in Paris,
and they would get matching dolphin tattoos, even Teddy. "Let's meet here at the fountains," they whooped, as they reached Place de la Concorde. Pointing at the huge Fontaine des Fleurs, illuminating arcs of water, creating crescent moons of gold, lambent drops falling like shooting stars over the tritons and mermaids, swinging from lampposts as they passed them, feeling like every movie, every moment, was seeping into their skin. This was their city. This is where it felt like their lives had finally begun. "Let's do it, though," they said later, as the sky began to lighten. "Let's really do it." Their fingers cold, their backs wet with dew, as they lay on the grass of the Jardin des Tuileries, sharing the blanket and Nina's cigarettes, the hum of the city beginning around them, the imposing architecture of Le Crillon behind them. "Let's meet up here every year, whatever happens." 12 hours in Paris. That's all it took to cement their futures. They would often wonder in the years ahead, what if Jules had never come across Nina in that bathroom? What if Alice and Teddy hadn't been there at all? Where and who would they all be now? Chapter 2. 20 years later. Friday, AM. Nina. Nina was humming a Florence and the Machine song as she scanned the busy concourse for a place to sit so she could rearrange the various items she was juggling. Magazines were slipping from her underarm and bulging paper bags from La City Patisserie were digging into her wrist on one side, while the other hand dragged along her suitcase, and the song in her head told her to shake it out. Jules had a problem with earworms, songs she couldn't forget that burrowed in her brain. So these days, whenever it happened, she sent a voice note of the song in question to her friends. The subsequent flurry of messages was usually a successful antidote, and, as Jules said, even if it wasn't, there was comfort in knowing the three of them were now listening to, or in Nina's case humming, the same tune. That's what had happened this morning, when their messaging group, when in Paris, had been particularly active. "My Uber driver is so fit. He looks like Keanu Reeves. Young or old, I would take either, to be fair. Lordy, I think I just wet myself running for the train." Nina loved the preamble to a weekend away. The joy of it was all part of the experience for her. It was 3 years since they had last all been in Paris together, and Nina sensed they needed a few days there now more than ever. She certainly did. From the corner of her eye, she thought she saw Alice. She squinted as she approached. Was that Alice? She had her look. Flippy skirt, chunky jumper and boots, wavy shoulder-length ombre hair, her slender frame and protruding cheekbones toned by the demands of parenthood. But it was hard to tell, hunched as she was, head in hands. It was only when Nina was practically on top of her and could see the small symbol of the Eiffel Tower etched in delicate black lines on her neck that she was absolutely sure. She glanced down at her wrist, red-lined by the takeaway bags, to her own matching Eiffel Tower tattoo. They had got them together to mark their 30th birthdays, deeming the Eiffel Tower more fitting than a dolphin. Jules was on her hip, discreet and not discernible in her work attire. 9 years ago, marvelled Nina with a smile. The wishy-washy feeling in her stomach she'd had since last night had intensified as she approached, but she recognised her nervous system calming as she sat down, reaching an arm around Alice in hello, grateful that she still doused herself in rose perfume and hairspray. It was reassuring. It made Nina feel like things would be okay. "Morning," she chirruped. She wasn't a natural chirruper. It broke the gentle melodic rhythm of her voice, honed through hours of yoga and mindfulness, and it came out high-pitched and forced. Alice started, reflexively shrugging off Nina's arm, her dark blue eyes blinking, as though she hadn't expected to see her there even though they were due to meet by the Eurostar entrance in 20 minutes. "Oh, Neen," she said, pulling her into a hug.
not seeming to notice the mini baguettes that must be poking into her ribs. "Are you okay?" Nina asked, pulling back, putting a hand to Alice's upper arm. She looked tired and anxious, and for a moment Nina forgot her own problems. She had been sure, as she tried to sleep last night, as she was in the shower this morning, as she slipped her passport into her bag before she left home, that with one look her oldest friends would have it figured out. But she realised, with a mix of gratefulness and guilt, that Alice had too much on her plate to notice how tired and anxious Nina was herself this morning.
"You're early," Alice said, miming intense surprise.
"I do that now," Nina said, grinning good-naturedly. Sometimes she found comments like this from Alice or Jules annoying. Sure, for the first 10 years of their friendship, she was usually late. But for the last 10, and definitely since Alice had had 3 kids, and Jules had been doing her thing in the city.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.